request Mr. Madanlal Raigar, Consul General of India, Hamburg, to give the welcome speech. Thank you.
Ambassador sir, ma'am, Veena Singh, President of India Business Forum, Dr. Singh, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to all of you. Bidding farewell are not an occasion to rejoice, but as we all know, in this all the time moving world, at one or the other time, we get separated from one of our beloved family members, best childhood buddies, school and college friends, and colleagues for various reasons in our life. And hence, separation and farewell are integral part of our social life. In a profession as ours, we diplomats are gypsies and have to keep moving our places of work and residence to other places so frequently, and especially our spouses are privy to this, and they never like this, but they have to endure it. But since Ambassador is getting superannuated after an illustrious diplomatic career spanning over almost 4 decades, he had the privilege of having served the motherland India with the prestigious diplomatic assignments, concluding with ambassadorship of the great European country, the nation Germany. He is retiring as one of the senior most Indian diplomats. With his vast experience as an able administrator, one of the top diplomats, a prolific writer and orator, I do not think the journey for him ends here. We will certainly get benefited by his writings, speeches, and maybe some other important assignment back home in India. Sir, you have been a fatherly figure and constant guide for us, and we will definitely going to miss you. Your so friendly advices and kind support. We also have among us Madam Hiru Singh. Though she will not be retiring, as she belongs to an Indian Premier Service IAS and works for various organizations of the United Nations. She has an abiding interest in environment, gender, and sustainable development issues. Though she will not be here in Germany after March, but will definitely keep sharing her knowledge with the Government of India and the United Nations. Sir, I'm glad to head our consulate here, which is one of the oldest Indian offices in Germany. Though the human resources at our disposal here at the consulate are limited, but I can proudly say that they are very efficient ones. Despite manpower, infrastructure, and resource constraints, we have been doing well as far as getting connected with the Indian diaspora, delivering efficient consular and visa services, maintaining good rapport with the government authorities, media, the trade and commercial establishments here, etc. We will make our best efforts to continue to do the same. With your blessings and support of our embassy in Berlin, we will also be able to efficiently handle the upcoming G20 summit here in Hamburg. Though your presence in Germany will definitely be missed at this important juncture. Wish you were there to guide us through this, but alas, I also take this opportunity to thank all office bearers and members of the Indian Business Forum for agreeing to jointly host this event to befittingly bid a farewell to our respected Ambassador Sir and Madam. Sir, we are here to listen more from you and not to speak too much ourselves. I conclude here with our prayers and wishes that Sir, you and Madam have a wonderful life ahead post March 2017 and keep blessing us from wherever you are. The world is very small and hope to see you sometime, somewhere, most probably in Delhi. Thank you so much. And now I would like to invite Ambassador Sir for his speech, which we all are eagerly waiting for.
First of all, I would like to present a copy of my new book on India and Germany, Opportunity Beckons, to my dear friend, Madan Lal Raigar. The President of ITLOS, President of India Business Forum and his wife and your other members of office members. This is Meera Ramesh, wife of my senior colleague. Madan and Vimla ji, I see many friends here. I know Mr. Theo Sommer was here, but perhaps he was there, but many other friends I see here from India and Germany. Thank you very much for coming here, giving us an occasion to meet you all before Neeru and I leave Germany. Hamburg was one of the very first places that we visited, and among all, after our farewells in Berlin, Frankfurt and Munich, this is the last stop. So thank you, Hamburg, for such perfect weather for the last 2 days. We couldn't have asked for more. We are always very impressed with Hamburg, ever since we came. And many of you contributed through your meetings, by talking to us, having wonderful meals together, getting advice from many of you. And you made us feel that whenever we Hamburg was like home. So I never felt that Hamburg was away from Berlin, and I didn't really have to plan too much to come here. So we turned up whenever we could. And we don't regret it, because I think Hamburg really has contributed a lot. Yes, I will miss being here at the G20, because I think that will be Prime Minister Modi's maiden visit to Hamburg. And I would very much have liked to be here, because many ways I consider Hamburg my city. But somebody will be here. In any case, nothing else, Vimla and Raigar will be here. So and the visit will go successfully. I think India will contribute to the G20 by emphasizing democratic values, functional cooperation, open systems, all of which are under threat today. Ladies and gentlemen, on a more serious note, the threat that I talk about today does not come necessarily from a coup, a riot, or a revolution. It comes from democracy. Democracy is turning on itself. It is giving us answers which we were not ready for. So where does the fault lie? Does the fault lie in democracy? I don't believe so. Does the fault lie in our systems? I don't believe so. I think the oracle in Delphi said it many centuries ago, man, know thyself. And I think that is where the fault lies. We lost a connect to ourselves. And today our political leaders perhaps do not understand the people anymore. Therefore, you get democratic results which are not per any prediction or any poll, but that is what the people want. In India, recently we had many elections, and in the state of Uttar Pradesh, which is huge, 125 million people, we had the ruling party sweep the state as nobody ever predicted. Why? It is because people realize that they want change, they want good governance, and they want delivery, and they are willing to exercise their democratic right for it. So the challenge to democracy today comes from democracy and our political willingness to engage. We know the dangers, how democracy can lead to certain consequences. It is up to us to reach out and convince people how the world should be made. But I think there is little point in complaining that democracies are wrong or gave wrong results, because since the time of the early republics in India or the time of Plato and Socrates, democracy is always right. It is the people who run them who need to rethink where they are. Between India and Germany, I think there are many things which can be done. You have mentioned some. So let me begin with the diaspora. The diaspora is the most wonderful arm of any Indian embassy or consulate. And I'm very happy that the India Business Forum was launched, and I've also met several representatives of the DIGs. What can I say? Do what you do well, but certainly do it more. That's all I can request you. Do it more. There are many new Indians coming. They are professionals, they are business people, they are students, they are academics. How do we bring them all into linkages with existing Indian associations or DITs or India Business Forum? During my time, reaching out to the diaspora was one of my main efforts. And besides trying to let the consulates reach out to the India Business Forum, in Berlin we set up the Indian Professionals Forum. Then we have, I think today, 16, Bala, 16 students
associations?
20, sir. 20 students associations. And Bala has been very helpful to us. And we have worked on setting up a portal, which the embassy has supports, but basically the students run. The idea is to bring students in every university together. And this is something we need to increase. And then, of course, we created the annual conference of Indian Diaspora Association, which I have honored to host twice, once when I had just come and once to say goodbye. I hope these will continue, because the diaspora which lives in Germany knows more than us diplomats, learns more than us diplomats, and can do more than us diplomats if properly harnessed. So it is very important that we remain engaged, and not simply remain engaged because either you need an OCI card or your passport got lost, but on substantive issues where we can learn from you. I remember at Mr. and Mrs. Sinha's house, I had a very nice gathering of Indians who have been here for some time. And I still remember my wife and I saying after that, that in that one evening, I learned so much about how young Indians who come to Germany work and what they think. And this is something which should guide us. So thank you very much indeed. There have been many of you who have contributed to this. So where at the end of my time do I think we have got? One of my biggest challenges was that the perception of India in Germany was not a good one. So we had to work hard on how to improve that perception. So one of the efforts I made was to have this book. It's called Opportunity Beckons. I did it between July and January of last, July last year, and we launched it in January. And there were two people from Hamburg who contributed to the book. Mr. Chiosoma was one, and Timo Prikop of OAV was the other. Basically, the book has 16 themes on which India and Germany, I believe, can do more. And I have 16 Indians, one of them is me, 15 more, and 16 Germans writing two per theme, from giving their point of view. So Mr. Theo Sommer wrote on foreign policy for the future. What foreign policy coordination can we do? And Mr. Timo Prokop wrote on trade. So the idea of this book was simply to connect India and Germany more. And I'm very happy to say that after my retirement, my first public appearance will be at an event called Opportunity Beckons, which will be in India a month from now, where we will tell India about this book and tell Indian businessmen how they must deal with Germany in a much better way. What we think we have achieved a better political understanding between India and Germany. Today, we know that it is not war which is bringing us together. And neither is geostrategy for India and Germany common. For instance, Germany thinks China is an economic opportunity. India thinks China is a strategic threat. Different perceptions. For you, Ukraine is important, for us, Nepal. So this strategy is different. So you can't really expect this to come along, because today neither of us are global powers. But the new threats, what are called the non-traditional threats, piracy, money laundering, migration, terrorism, cybercrime, these unite us, because these are global challenges. And if India and Germany have to do more, this is an area that we all need to look at. And that is something we are looking at. If you look at the next area of economy, today Germany is our biggest trading partner in the EU. And it's only in the top 10 of investors into India. In the last 3 years, more Indian investment has come to Germany than the other way around. And we are the ones promoting investment. So something must be wrong with us that we're not getting it right. In simple facts, the German surplus is a problem. We don't need Mr. Trump to say Germany needs to realize it. It is a problem. But we are not saying that you have balanced trade with India. We are saying Germany owes the countries who are its best partner to go and invest more and do it for your own economic benefit. We are very happy that in my time, the German government has put forward a first-time proposal called Strategic Financing of Infrastructure. It says Asia, but it's actually India. And in that, they are ready to finance very large projects like Japan does. This has been a very positive move, which I highly welcome. And I thank everybody in the German government. Now we have to come to projects. And if you saw some of those pictures, a lot of them focus on the railways, because the railways is one area, the high-speed railway, or the speed upgradation railway, where something could really happen. And when infrastructure sector of India attracts more German investment, then this relationship will boost, because Germany is basically a Mittelstand country, and at the Mittelstand level, you can have tens of millions of dollars, not hundreds of millions of dollars. But that is not to say that we are ignoring the Mittelstand. One of my successes in my time has been the Make in India Mittelstand program, which from a fledgling promotional issue has now become a solid partnership base, that today we have 70 companies on board, and 30 of them have made business plans to go to India. And we have got, within 1 year, about $500 million of investment, which for the Mittelstand actually is quite big. So I think the economy directions are clear, they're moving forward. The Mittelstand is very close to my heart. In fact, in the book, my own contribution is my chapter on the Mittelstand. And I really hope that we can push that ahead. Now comes two important areas where we took initiative. One was academics and the other was students. So we tried to coordinate the large number of students coming. We realized that with Britain going down, the number of Indian students going there is decreasing, and more students are coming to Germany. It makes us happy. So, but we need better situations for them. We need to address their housing issues. We need to make sure their visas are long enough for them to settle in, and they don't face America-like problem that if I don't do this in time, I'll be deported. We also want the students to come in a larger number of areas. We want that the Indo-German Education Partnership, which has a very large amount of money which is lying unutilized, should actually use it more. So the other day we had a meeting at the working level, and I pleaded with the German partners to think of expanding the sectors where the Indo-German Economic Partnership can work. One of the sad parts are the chairs that India used to run. They have been diminishing, they are not coming in, the German side has not shown the kind of enthusiasm they could. So I don't quite understand it. They have put a lot of money into the Indo-German economic education partnership, but they don't give money to the universities to sustain the chairs that India did. So today I find that the best chairs running are in Leipzig and Hanover, we hope. But we are very clear that these have to run on a partnership model, not on an India-funded model. So that is another area of concern. An area where we have done rather well is in science and technology, where new partnerships are on the anvil. India and DC in Hamburg have already got a partnership. Indian rockets are launching German satellites. This is an area we really want to take forward and have more partnerships. And the Indo-German Science and Technology Center has now got a new head, doubled the funding. So we really hope some lighthouse projects will come up. I think to conclude, I would say, where does the problem of the future lie? The problem of the future still lies in a better understanding that Indians must have of Germany, and certainly Germans must have of India. The media here is not helpful to our cause. So we have expanded our social media reach. All of those who are not on our social media, please go to Facebook, India in Germany, and like it, or follow us on Twitter. We need your support over there. You know, this is where I call the Max Müller syndrome and the Beethoven syndrome. And these are big problems for us. Max Müller, very well known in India as a name, and he knew almost everything about India of that day, and nobody knew more than him. But he never went to India. So this kind of armchair journalism and academics is not conducive to a positive role. We want more academics, more students, more tourists to go to India. And we tell you that what your newspaper says is true, but that is not the only truth about India. The second is the Beethoven syndrome. When I was in Bonn, they very kindly took me into the vaults of the Beethoven house to show me original handwritten letters by Beethoven. And I think this was in 1799. And he writes to his publisher, "I want my works all over the world. Calcutta, Pondicherry, Greenland, North America." So they said, "What do you think?" I said, "The Germans have been wanting to export to India from there and buy nothing in return. We don't make perhaps music as good as Beethoven, but we could have made the drum, we could have made the string for the guitar. There's something we have to do to set up complementarity." And that can only happen if more people go. Ladies and gentlemen, to conclude, let me say, last night I was at the OAV annual dinner. And one thing I can say, that today there is a much better understanding that these two syndromes need to be addressed. I find people who have been to India once are going three times. People who have some idea want to do more. Today, more people come to me to say, "I have a problem doing this," rather than saying, "Oh, what a great democracy you are. I could do without your certificate. I'll be happy if you went to India to invest and came to us and we try and solve your problem." That is what I really need. Democracy, I can give you a certificate. You're a great democracy too. But where does that get us? It doesn't get us anywhere. And democracies are a challenge. So ladies and gentlemen, Hamburg, thank you so much for being the support that India needs. You have been the host of the first Indian trade mission, I think in 1932. Rabindranath Tagore, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, all have had their feet on this ground. And you are the one city which celebrates India Week every alternate year. We are grateful to Hamburg, to all our friends over here, and we hope that you will continue to support the Indian endeavor and support Vimla and Madan very much in their endeavor as well as the Indian Business Forum. Thank you very much.
I request please come forward, and Mr. Raigar and Mrs. Singh.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
we cannot pay back to you, sir or madam. But it's always a gesture, a tradition that you carry forward and take some memories of the place where you have been. And as you already appreciated Hamburg, it's a beautiful place. Memento from Hamburg, and we would like to give it a vote of you.
Contribute to taking the agenda forward.
Sir, thank you very much. Certainly, we will progress on this.
Say that we have among us a very young boy, Christopher Singh. Please come forward. He has recently been awarded an appreciation letter signed by the German president and the Federal Minister of Economy, Cooperation and Development for his work as a documentary which he made, and he stood
fourth
in the category 11 and 13. So we are proud of you, and we take this opportunity to give our appreciation to you through our ambassador, His Excellency.
Thank you. I'm sorry we came, but we're in the lunch, but I think now we can enjoy it.